Okay, so in the last video, that is in the last session, we had discussed with a few of the concepts of, that is the introduction concepts of a Unix subject, that is Unix programming subject. So in that, the few of the concepts was discussed on the introduction part of Unix, like what actually an operating system, before entering into an Unix, what is an operating system is, what are the common features of an operating system in context with one example I had discussed, followed by even we had discussed with the features of a Unix also. Along with that, even in the previous session, we had discussed with differences between the Unix and then Windows operating system. So these are the concepts which we have already discussed in the previous session. So the next topic in this subject is, that is history of a Unix. So let us know about from where actually this Unix operating system came into existence. So this Unix operating system, as I have already framed, like Unix operating system is also it's almost like a Windows operating system. Both are none are the same, one are the same, but the thing is, here we do have few features which is going to vary between the Unix operating system as well as with that of a Windows operating system. When compared to a Windows operating system, as I have already mentioned in the previous session, that is Unix operating system is very secure when compared to a Windows operating system, right? So here this Unix operating system, how it came into existence. Here now, initially when this Unix operating system came into existence, the researchers from the General Electric Bell Laboratory, that is Massachusetts Institute of Technology. So from this, actually the researchers in the late 1960s, they actually developed a project in a joint venture for developing a system, that is which comprises of multi-user multitasking OS for framework computer, that is compute for a framework computers here. So initially they were developed a system in the late 1960s in the researchers lab, that is in the General Electric Bell in the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. A few researchers in a joint venture, they actually build a project for this Unix operating system which supported both a Unix multi-user and a multitasking OS. Okay, so for a mainframe computers, so actually this was developed for a mainframe computers. So this mainframe computers was named as what? Multics, that is multiplex information and computing system. So this Multics actually is been abbreviated as multiplex information and computing system. So this was the system which was actually built as a project in a joint venture for actually building an ambitious multi-user multitasking operating system for a mainframe computers, which is known as what? Multics. Later on, this Multics actually failed for few of the things for getting into an existence for that in that particular era. So later on, Ken Thompson, again who was a researcher in the same laboratory, he actually rewrote the same operating system once again, and he actually built an operating system, that is which has been known as what? Unix, that is Uniplexed, which has been abbreviated as Uniplexed Information and Computing System. Uniplexed Information and Computing System. So this Ken Thompson, who was a researcher in the Bell Laboratory, so he rewrote the same operating system in a simple version of a Multics by using he wrote that Unix operating system on the mini computer like PDP-7 assembler. So by using this, he actually rewrote the OS, which was named as what? Unix. And this Unix has been completely abbreviated as Unix Uniplexed Information and Computing System. Since in that time, because of memory and the CPU power were at a very premium in those days or in those eras, so the Unix used a very short commands for processing any kind of information within a system. As we have already discussed in the introduction part of an Unix, that Unix always it will accept what for any kind of processing, always you are going to access that information through commands itself. So through command itself you are going to process any kind of or access the resources from that through the command itself, right? So just to in those eras the CPU power were at a very premium, as well as to just to reduce the memory space and minimize the memory space to store all those information, they decoded them by using they actually decoded all this into a simple Unix commands. Simple Unix commands. So if I consider a simple Unix commands, which was actually he developed for processing any kind or accessing as well as for processing means, might be it is for listing out any files if I consider ls command, or might be if I want to know who was the user who was using the system, so that might be done again processed and known by using what who command. So this is how a simple Unix command came into existence by using this Unix. It is Uniplexed Information and Computing System, which was basically developed by using this PDP-7 assembler. Okay, so this is how the Unix version of a simple Unix operating system was rewritten by a Ken Thompson when a multiplexed information and computing system was failed. Okay, so the Ken Thompson, a researcher at the Bell Laboratory, he again rewrote the same OS, which was known as what? Unix. And in that sense, in those eras, it was very that is very premium for accessing the CPU power usage, or might be it is a memory space, or might be the time consuming, all these taking into consideration, they came up with what defining a simple Unix command for actually accessing the operating system, Unix operating system. So these are the few example or simple commands which I have listed out here. So later on, the Ken Thompson then teamed up with a Dennis Ritchie, who was an author for the first C compiler. Okay, so in 1973, they rewrote again this Unix version of an operating system with the Unix kernel in C. Unix kernel in C. So this was again a rewritten the Unix with the Unix kernel in C in 1973 with Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie. So by with these two combination of authors, they actually came up with a new version of an Unix operating system, that is Unix kernel in C. So this was a big step which was actually forwarded in terms of the system portability. So as I have already mentioned in the Unix operating system, that is one of the features, Unix operating system is very portable, which means that on any kind of that is on any machine, on any of the hardware platform, this machine is or sorry on the on any of the machine, this hardware operating system can be installed, right? So that feature was actually done after the version defined within Unix, that is Unix kernel in C in 1973. So next they released with the fifth edition of the Unix version in the university in 1974, the fifth version of the Unix edition of the Unix to universities. So likewise later on again in the eighth edition was this was with the fifth edition of which was actually built or released for especially for universities. Okay, so next they came up with the eighth edition, which was actually split up into two kinds. One is with the Unix development was actually split up into two main branches. One is System V and the other one is Berkeley Software Distribution. System V, Berkeley Distribution Software, BDS. Okay, sorry, it's BSD, Berkeley Software Distribution. So these were, these two was splitted up in the 8th edition of Unix operating system. So this is how the Unix came into existence, or the brief history how the Unix operating system came into existence later from 1960s to till now. So we do have now in the modern, that is nowadays, we are actually using the Linux operating system. Again, it's a part of a Unix operating system. It's not completely different. So it's a part of a Unix operating system, whereas Unix will define your complete package, whereas Linux, which is a part of it. So we are using a Linux as well as the Unix operating system. So nowadays we do have both. So this is how the Unix operating system came into existence, with few of the authors which was developed in the MIT, that is Massachusetts Institute of Technology, in late 1960s. Initially they developed as Multics. Later on, Ken Thompson defined the same and rewrote the same OS with Unix by using the C routines. Later he actually developed with the simple command for processing and accessing the resources within a system. Then he teamed up with Dennis Ritchie and rewrote the same OS, Unix OS, with a Unix kernel in C, and likewise followed by in the 5th edition was again released for universities in 1974. Later on, the 8th edition, that is, which was actually split up into two version, System V and Berkeley Software Distribution. So this is how the Unix history of a Unix is all about, how it came into existence. So the next topic in this is Unix architecture. So the architecture, how actually the OS has been designed, or the architecture has been analyzed. So you need to know about the Unix operating system, its architecture also, right? What actually it comprises of, which and all the components in the Unix operating system is, right? So in that Unix operating system architecture, we do have few of the components, like one is the kernel, shell, followed by file and processes, and the last but not the least, that is system calls. So these are the few components which has been defined or comprised within the Unix architecture. One is kernel and shell, file and processes, and the last one is system calls. So this is about the Unix architecture components. So I'll just write down the architecture, how actually it describes, all these four components. So how it has been assembled, or how it has been organized within the Unix operating system. So I'll just write down the architecture design of it, how it has been written. So as we all know that in a Windows operating system, as I've discussed, you do have a direct access with that of a hardware, whereas here we don't have that. Instead, always through kernel itself you have to access any hardware services. So that is what the kernel part does, and this is the main heart of the Unix operating system, like a kernel itself. So kernel is one of the component which is very important, and this is the one which is going to manage all kinds of system calls and its operations. Like, it might be a memory management, CPU scheduler, priorities for execution of a program, anything. So all is being managed by and maintained by using this kernel itself. And if you want to access the hardware resource by using the system call function itself, you have to access this kernel services. So next is what about this kernel? Always you will have what? The shell. So shell is one more component which acts as an interface between what? The hardware and the user application. So kernel guno, user application which the user want to access. So it might be any kind of a program, and if you want to access that with the hardware resources, or if you want to access directly with the hardware means or its services, then through this shell components itself you have to access. So this is the one which is going to interpret any kind of the information what you have given within a system. So this is what about a shell. It acts like an agent between the kernel and the user. So next is what, in this shell itself, we do have few of the commands as I've already specified. So this is a CP command, which is basically used for copying it. Next we do have a grep command, Grep is used for matching the patterns within a given sentence or a given file. Next, this is a tar command. Tar command is basically used for what? Accessing the zip files. Okay, so like if you have already have a zip files within a system, so if you want to access those zip files, how you are going to access it? So by using this tar command you can access it. And likewise we do have ps command. So ps command is basically used for what? Process. So if the user want to know what kind of process, in which process terminal he is actually using it, so that can be known by using this ps command. Next, who command. So who is basically, this is going to get you about like who is the user using the terminal. Okay, so that detail if you want to know means, then you can access this who command. Likewise, set command. So set command is basically, again, this is used for what? Accessing the, like if you want to match or a line of code, sorry, from a line of sentence in a file. Okay, so if you want to match that by using this SED command, you can actually do that. Next is what? Sort command. So sort, as the in the name itself it says that, sort command is basically used for what? Sorting any kind of, then LS command. Likewise, we do have so many commands. So as of now we are going to just discuss with few of the commands here. Just for the representation purpose, we are going to understand these commands. We do have lots of commands in the Unix for accessing any kind of resource within the Unix operating system, might be for performing any action or accessing the resources. So all these, for doing all these kind of an operation, you are going to use the commands itself. So how these commands will be interpreted? So these commands will be interpreted by using what? This shell. So shell is going to interpret that command. It will going to evaluate, process it and evaluate it, and identify what kind of process that is, what kind of process it is using and what kind of an output it has to get. That will be again interpreted, then only it is going to provide the same for kernel for processing it or for the execution. Okay, so next is what? So this is about the shell. So what actually the shell does. Next is about this, we do have a compiler for the execution of any programming language. Likewise, we do have other compilers also. Okay, so next we do have a browsers. We do have text processors. So all these are applications, right? So which will be again used by the user. So this is going to be again about the shell, right? So because shell is the one which is going to interpret all these application which has been defined by the user. So next we do have what? One more, that is databases. Database application if you want to access. Likewise, we do have a spreadsheets. So if you want to access any spreadsheets, even it might be text processor, even a word processor also you can access. Likewise, if you want to access any Windows application, so even that can also be accessed. Likewise, any other softwares. Other softwares. So this is how the Unix operating system has been defined. So all this through the user itself, you are going to provide the information. Shell, whatever the command you are going to input for the shell, that will be through the user itself. So all these what I have written outside the shell is all are a user application programs. So this user application program will be interpreted by the shell. After interpreting it, that will be evaluated and executed by what? Kernel, by getting the access services from the hardware. So how, again, how it is going to get the access of those services is by calling a system calls, by using this functions which has been defined within the system calls of a Unix operating system. So by using this, it is going to access all the hardware services or the resources. So this is about your Unix architecture. So how, which and all the components comprised within the Unix operating system. One is the hardware, as of course we all know, hardware and software idda irutte. So in between these hardware and software component, by using these two component, one is the kernel and the shell, you are going to access what? Any kind of a program. It might be for the addition purpose, or it might be for performing any action, or it might be for storing the content within a system or within that, or it might be for processing the information, and finally execution. So all these will be done within this by using this kernel. And kernel, how it is going to access? By calling a system call and getting the information from the hardware component. So let me just give you a brief definition, or it's not definition, a brief introduction about what actually kernel is, what is a shell is, what is a system calls are. And as I've mentioned, in the user application we do have a different files and processes, right? Any kind of a process, that is a software which you can execute. So what actually all these are, right? So all these components, let me give you each and every component what it is. So kernel, so if I consider this kernel, what actually this kernel consists of? So as I've said, kernel is the one which is defined as a heart of a Unix operating system. So it always consists of a collection of a C routines. Okay, so it consists of collection of C routine. So as soon as the system has been booted up, so it is going to load the memory. When the system has been, all the memory will get loaded into it. Okay, and finally it is going to communicate that with the hardware. So since it is the heart of the Unix operating system, once you switch on your system for booting, that is once you boot up your system, that is on your system, so what it does is it is going to load the memory and finally communicate that with that of a hardware for any kind of a accessing or performing the performing or processing the contents. It might be any user application or any user program also. So user application then that need to access the kernel, that is that needs to access the hardware services, then it has to again go through what? Kernel, by calling what? The system calls, as I already mentioned. So by calling the system call, since within the system call we do have some of the functions defined, so by using these functionalities it is going to execute whatever the user has been provided, in which it has to access the hardware services means. So on behalf of the user, at that time it is going to call this system call by using a functionalities defined within it. So then you can access what? The hardware services on user behalf by accessing through that of a kernel. Next, even this, as I've already mentioned, so kernel is going to maintain few of the features. It is going to maintain and manage the system memory, schedule the processes, as well as it is going to decide which process has to get the higher priority so that it can execute for the user, and also it performs any other task which is not being performed by the user. Okay, so these are the few of the things which is going to be managed by the kernel. And also this kernel is the only component that can communicate between the hardware, and that is, it is the only component which is going to communicate with that of a hardware component within a Unix operating system. So this is what about the kernel. And this kernel acts as a gateway for the shell or for the user program which you are going to provide for the execution. Okay, so this is the one of the gateway for accessing any kind of hardware services. Then as an intermediary between the user and the kernel, we do have a shell component. So now, like, coming on to this shell component, what actually it does. So as I've already defined, it is an agent, or it acts like an agent between the user and the kernel. So what actually this shell does? So it is like an it is a command interpreter, okay? So which is going to interpret the commands which you have provided for any kind of accessing the resources or the programs you want to execute. Okay, so first it is going to accept that command, okay, whatever the command you have given. So that will be evaluated, and it will be that processing will be done by the kernel. So evaluate during the evaluation purpose, it is going to match with different kinds of a meta characters so that it can have what whichever the meta characters it has been given. For example, if I consider this ls command, so if I want to list out the few of the files, so in that files might be few files name might be the same. So if I want to list out all the similar files means might be I'll be using what few of the meta character which is going to list out me all the similar files. Okay, so at that time, so it is going to even process that meta character, evaluate that meta character, not process, it is going to evaluate that meta character and finally identify the path where actually it has to execute that program in the kernel. Okay, so this is how the shell works and finally it will be executed by accessing the kernel and hardware services provided by using the system call. So this is how the shell consists of, or the shell it is going to work. Followed by next, we do have after you shell, we do have what about that shell user components, right? Or the user application or the user program. So in this user program, we can have what file and processors also. So if the user want to access any kind of a, what do you mean by a file? That is any kind of a file. In the file, what actually it consists of? Information. It is like a raw data or data which all consists about the information. Even you can define that as an array of bytes which comprises of the information itself. Okay, so that is what this file has and what actually the process does. So process is nothing but it's an executable code, that is executable, a piece of information or a piece of code which is used for execution purpose. Okay, or it acts like an image of that program for the execution purpose. So this file and process, even all those file and processes are related to what? It might be any kind of a text file, or it might be any kind of spreadsheet file, or it might be any other files for accessing, or a programming file itself for execution purpose. So all those files and processes will be defined at the user application. Next, last but not the least in this last one component is what? System call. So what actually this system call does? So system call here in the Unix operating system, it comprises what? The kernel, the shell and the application which is written in the C. So system uses a handful functions of this which is called as what? System call. All these functionalities are the components of a Unix operating system, that is shell, kernel and the hardware, which is all, sorry, not hardware, shell and kernel, which is written in the C routines, okay, by using those C routines. So for accessing all these, we are going to use a system call, which has been defined with that of a functions. So for communication between the kernel, you are going to what? Use this system call, that of the kernel and the hardware, for accessing the hardware components. So this is how the Unix architecture is being designed, and also it comprises of what? These components. One is the kernel, shell, user application actually defines with that a file and process, followed by what? Next is system calls. So these are the components it comprises of, which is being comprised with Unix architecture. Unix architecture. Okay. So this is how it has been designed. So the next thing, I hope you people have understood this. So that what actually the Unix operating system architecture has been comprised of. So kernel, shell, system calls and file and processes. So kernel, as I've said, it is a heart of a Unix operating system and it manages, so once you have boot up the system, so it is going to load with the memory and communicates with that of a hardware. So for the communication with that of a hardware, it is going to use what? System calls, which has been defined with that of C routines. Okay, next shell, what it does, so and also kernel, what it does is it is going to manage all the system functionalities, and also it is going to manage the memory, and also it is going to decide the priority to which program it has to provide for execution purpose. So all these has been managed by the kernel, and also next it is a gateway for accessing any kind of a hardware resources. Next, shell component, it is an agent between the kernel and the user, and it is a command interpreter which is basically used for interpreting the command. So it is going to first accept the input that is a command, then that will be evaluated and processed and identified. A path will be identified for the execution of within the kernel. Okay, so that is what the shell does. And here within this shell, you can represent, that is, the shell has been represented with different variants for the execution of any kind of a commands. So in that variants, we do have four kinds of representation of shell. One is the C shell, then bourne shell, then conch shell, and not last one is bash shell. So by using these, any one of the shell, you can interpret the command. So usually bash and conch shell has been used in the Unix operating system most of the time, bash and kch. So bash and conch, but all these are the four shells which has been represented for interpreting the command: C shell, bourne shell, conch shell, and bash shell. So next is we'll discuss with, after this component, we do have system calls. So system calls, as I said, it within the Unix system, it comprises of the kernel and the shell. So all these have been written in C. So for accessing all these or communicating with that of the hardware, you are going to use what? System calls, which in which it defines the all the functionalities. Not but the least, user application has been accessed through the command interpreter shell, and kernel is going to execute the program. The next topic in this is, we'll see with few of the basic commands of a Unix operating system. So which and all the basic Unix commands which can be understood for, so that you can access any kind of a resource or perform some actions within the Unix operating system. So what are all those basic commands? We'll just look into it. So here we do have one of the command, locating basic Unix command. Locating file. So how do we locate the Unix files? So all the Unix commands are single word commands, which is like ls command, cp command, like this. All these are what? A single word command. So these names are in the lowercase. And since, as I've already mentioned, in the Unix operating system, it is a case sensitive, which means you can't use, if it has been used as an ls command with the small case, you have to use in this way itself. If you give capital L and S, it doesn't accept. So if the user want to locate the location of the executable program which is going to use, then he can, if the user want to know which is the location of an executable program which is executing, at that time he can locate that file program by using one of the command called type command. So type followed by ls. Okay, so if you just give this type followed by ls command, so this ls command is going to locate the type of the program which you are going to execute. Now which is the command I have given for locating? So here I have given what? Ls command. So I want to know where actually this ls command has been located. So if you just give type followed by ls, so this is the command which you need to know the location where exactly it has been located means. So it is going to give you like /bin/ls, and this is the command prompt. Dollar is the command prompt, primary command prompt within the Unix operating system. So always it will be displayed within the system. So I am going to show you the execution of these commands also. Okay, in the later sessions I am going to show you all these commands, how it is going to execute by using a Unix operating system, and how you get the output of it. Okay, so this is the output you are going to get So this is the output you are going to get once you execute the type command, that is locating the file. So whichever the file you want to locate, the program executable file location you want to locate, so that can be done by using this type command. So next we do have one more command, that is, or it is not a command, it's an environmental variable. So what actually this path variable does? So this is a variable, okay, so if the user want to know the sequence of directory which he is going to search for any of the file means, so at that time he can know this by just by typing this path variable with that of an echo command, like echo followed by path variable. Okay, so if you just type the echo here again, so what does this echo command does? So this is going to display the echo is usually used for displaying the messages. So as we know in the C programming, like for displaying the messages or printing the message, we are going to use printf statement, right, or printf functionality. Here in the Unix operating system, you can use for printing the same message as in C, with that of a Unix operating system, you can use what? Echo command. So this is the one of the command, echo command, which is used for what? Displaying the messages. So here if you want to display the sequence of directory which you are searching for, the user is searching for, so that sequence of directory can be written by using this environmental variable, that is path variable. Okay, so this is one more variable which is used for locating, sorry, for displaying the sequence of directories that the shell searches to look for any kind of a command within a system. So by using the echo, you can execute, you can know the sequence of directory. So next command after this type and path environmental variable, we do have the next one of the basic command, that is ls command itself. What does this ls command does? So this is the syntax for using this. So if you just give, let me assume that I am under the directory. So if I have a root directory, under this directory I have a bin directory, subdirectory. Under this root I do have a bin subdirectory. Here I do have different files, like program 1, program 2, okay. It might be with any extension, might be with the doc file, or it might be with any .c files also, okay. So let me assume I do have these two files within the bin directory. Now if I want to list out those two files which is located under the bin directory means, always first it should be have what? The directory should be located under this bin directory. So then only you can, if you just give under this directory, if you just give the command ls, this is these two files is going to be displayed. Under any directory you are in the system, it might be under root directory, or you are under your subdirectory also means. So if you just execute the ls command, the ls command basic feature is what? It is going to list you the list of files, or display the list of files. So that is what this ls command does. Okay, so next within after this ls command, we do have a date command. One more basic command in the Unix is what? Date command. So by using this date command, dollar date, so if you just specify like this and execute a date command means, so it is going to display you the day and the date of today's month of today, and at what time actually you have executed that date command. So this is what you are going to get. So first always it will display you what? The day, which is the day of day. Next the month, that is now if it is August means, so August, and the day number. Okay, so now today is, if I consider it as an 18th means, so Tuesday, August 18th, and the time it might be, now it is 1 o'clock. Again here it is a 24 format system in the time, so here we are it is showing you 13.15 like this. So it is going to show you the hour, minute, followed by seconds also, okay, with that of the Indian standard time, that is IST. And here 2020, like this. So this is how you are going to get you the output or the information when you execute what? The date command. So it is going to display you the day of, which day today is, and the day number, followed by what? Again, it displays you the, which is the month, whether it is in August or it is in November, December, October, like that, followed by the time. In the time, it specifies the hour, minute and second, followed by with the Indian standard time, followed by the year. Okay, so this is what the output you are going to get when you execute the date command. We do have one more basic command along with that, that is cal command. So what does this cal command does? So if I just provide a cal within the Unix operating system like this means, so cal command, what it does is it is going to always display you with the complete year. So this is one more basic command of what? A Unix operating system, that is cal command. Along with this, as I've already specified, one more is who command. So what does this who command does? So who here, always it specifies the account of all the current users of the system. So if the user want to know the current users of the system, the accounts of the current user of the system, if the user want to know who is executing means, who and all is actually using the terminal of that system means, so that can be known by using this who command. So here always it displays the output in this format, root console, followed by so root followed by console. Then if I am executing in this month, so August, that is the month, it is going to be displayed with that of a timing, okay, followed by, so this is how it is going to display. So sorry, it is August followed by 18th, then the timing, it is going to display like this. So now root, what actually this root displays here? So this will give you the console, this is the this root will provide you the who is actually using the terminal. So if one of the person like Vipul or it might be Raj, so like this, if these two persons are using means, so these two, Vipul and Raj, is going to use the terminal type 1 TTY. So TTY and 1, so TTY is nothing but terminal type, sorry, here it is going to display the PTS/1, PTS/2 and August 18th might be with that of what? 1321, like this. So this is how it is going to display the current users of the system. So if the who and all actually has logged into the terminal type, so this actually represents the terminal type PTS, okay. So processor type system, who is actually using that, so that will be known by the executing just with what? Dollar who command, like this. Likewise, we do have one more command, that is PS command. This is used for process view, for knowing the processes, viewing the processes, actually which and all the processes it has been executing within a terminal. So for knowing that, you can use this PS command. So this PS command here, it represents PID, the output, what kind of, how you are going to get the output, who are actually viewing the processes. So for knowing the process information, you are going to execute this PS command. So what kind of information it will going to display here is PID, that is process ID, followed by TTY, that is terminal type, then time, then followed by the command. So now if I consider the process ID of the for the command, let me consider I have executed the ls command. So if I want to know the process information about this ls command means, so might be at the time 1:10 I have executed that ls command, and the terminal type here it is a console. So in the console window I am actually executing the command ls, and for this process ID it might be 41, like this. any process, unique identification number. PID here represent a unique identification number, okay, process ID. So that number and the console terminal type, okay, followed by the time at what time this command has got executed. So if to know the process information, you are going to use this PS command. Okay, so this is one more basic command of it. One more is what? Tput command. So tput command here, what it actually represents. So tput command here, it represents for the user, if the user want to clear the screen which he is executing within a console window. He might have executed so many commands, but he want to clear all those commands which he has got as an output in that particular screen. And if you want to just move out all those information means or clear those information, so that can be done by using this tput command. So always for this tput command, you have to provide the argument that is clear as an argument for clearing the screen of that window. Okay, so the execution of this tput command is like this, tput followed by clear. So if you just gave an argument clear for to that of a command tput means, so it is going to clear the screen, whichever the console window screen you have opened, and if you have written, if you have executed n number of command, that is few of the commands in that screen means, so all those will be cleared and it will be what? You will get what? A new command or a screen will get cleared and the screen will not be having any other information. So by now on that you can execute what? New commands in that particular screen. So for clearing the screen, you are going to use what? Tput command. Next we do have echo command, as I have already specified. Echo command, what it does? If you just execute the command echo. So echo here, it displays the message. So if the user want to print the message, any kind of a message, if you just give echo followed by hello all. So if I have given like this, always it should, since if you are providing a single letter, then you can enclose that in a single quote. Since I'm providing more, a sequence of character or a string of character has been defined there. So I'm enclosing that with a double quotes. So if I just give hello all, so that will just displayed hello all. Echo, it is going to just echo the same string message what you have provided in along with the echo command. Okay, hello all will be displayed. And likewise, we do have one more command, that is tty command. What actually this tty command does? So tty, as I have already specified, terminal type, but here in this it is going to display the device files which is currently working by the user. So if the user want to know under which device file he is actually working, then by using this tty command, he can know the device files which he is actually executing. Might be terminal 1 or terminal type 2, like this. So the all your device files are working under terminal type 1, terminal type 2, like this. Okay, so this is about your terminal, that is tty command. So these are the few of the basic commands. We do have other commands also, but we'll discuss later on with all those commands. But just for understanding purpose, what actually this Unix command is all about and what it does. So all these commands what I've explained so far will get interpreted by the shell. So shell is the one component which is going to interpret all those commands, okay, which you are going to execute in your terminal of a Unix operating system. So once you boot up your system, always it will open with your terminal. So within that terminal, for accessing any kind of information, you have to edit what? A command. Command has to get executed. So those commands, those simple commands, just for understanding purpose. So I have explained what? These are the basic commands. Okay. So locating a file, type command we are going to use. And for knowing the sequence of directory which the user is going is been searching for, so that can be known by one of the environmental variable, that is path variable, followed by next is what? That path variable will get executed by using an echo command itself. Okay, next we have discussed with the who command, we have discussed with the date command, cal command, then ps command, tput command, echo and tty command. So we do have, even if you want to know the word counts. Okay, so let me consider if I have a file. So within that file, that is text file, within that text file, if I want to count the number of words within that text file, means of course you can count the number of words which has been defined within that text file by using one of the command, that is wc command. So that is one more command, that is wc command word count. So what actually this does is, it is going to give you the word count. So the execution of it has been executed, it is like wc followed by any text file. So file dot text, if you give as an argument to that wc command, so in the file dot text file, if I have a 10 words, so that will get listed out. Okay, so specifically you can even list out the number of lines, number of words, number of characters defined within that text file. So for that you have to provide an argument along with the wc that we'll discuss in the later sessions also. Okay, so in the next session I'm going to continue with the next topic. Okay, so thank you all.